So the first part is to be passionate about what you do, like what you do and do it very well. And this is one thing, you know, I often felt like, you know, these are my top three passions, because I look at my journey, I would really look at, you know, what really touches my heart. And first is my own background. I'm actually a Chinese, you know that. And so any business related to China, I felt, you know, I have something I really want to do. I really, you know, that's something I'm good at it, I like it, I, you know, feel a buzz about it. Second one is women in business and startup business. Because of, like, myself, you know, how I started in Australia, and also I start up with a $49 USB and go to internet cafe to print out my booklet or print out my proposal and set up, you know, have a client meeting in a coffee club. And in a way, everything is run very minimal. I have very little money. However, through that particular startup phase, I realized, you know, the passion can drive people so long away. And I love to, you know, inspire, you know, my colleague or my friends or the business people around me and who went through the same journey. And the next passion is educational opportunity for underprivileged children in China. Myself, you know, I would say the reason, one big step for me to really step up is because of the education I got in China when I was little. And we are not very wealthy, you know, we probably like, we buy the egg, that's, at that time it's probably only less than 5 cents per egg. And, but it is very, so like, my mom can, we allocate a certain amount of money and each month to buy the egg and to buy the food. However, mom would always allocate a certain amount of money for our education, never hesitate. If we need to buy books or if we need to go higher education, and they always allocate half of the income or even more for, you know, our education. That's what I felt, you know, what really contributed me to where I am. So, you know, while looking back, sometimes I ask myself, Lindy, if you could choose anywhere in the world and any place you would and any career you could have, what job would you choose? And looking back and the whole thing, my answer is, you know, I wouldn't give up my job in China Direct Sourcing. And I really, you know, just love my business. I love the whole thing about it, the team, and also the whole work. And so therefore, you know, if that is something really hit me up going, it's like a canvas. My passion is my canvas. It's really just, you know, keep me going. And every day in the morning, I wake up, like Monday morning, I say, hoo-hoo, you know, time to get, like, make more money. And not only that. And it's time to, you know, be with the team again. I'm going to share with you why being with my team is such a joy. And it's really great fun. Like, you know, I have, you know, like I will talk about the team part. And it's really to, you know, just be, because I really like what I do and I want to do it very well. And so therefore, and in that way, and I was, you know, I'm always thinking how to continuously improve our system, how to continuously, you know, improve our, like, became, from here, became a leading sourcing company. And that really takes something. And so, and not only just that I have a wish, but also I have a methodology or I have a method. And is thinking about, you know, to provide excellent customer service is to educate my customer what to expect. And, you know, how many of you are in service business? Yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, yeah, most of you. All right, in that case, you know, in service industry, when we talk about giving a service to a particular client, and, you know, sometimes we find it's quite very hard, especially delivery service that is tangible. You don't know how to measure, you don't know what to measure, and you try to give customer wow, but because customer don't know what to expect either. So what we do is we actually educate our customer what to expect, and we deliver more than what we promise. Say for instance, in stage one, and we are very, very clear and to explain to our customer, and in stage one, what you will get. When we undertake our client project, that we, at the end of the stage one, we promise our customer the following three things. And you will have the supply sample report. You know, we will contact more than 30 suppliers in our category. There are probably more than, you know, like around 10 or 11 suppliers would express the interest. We will give you the supply summary report, which contains all their information. And not only that, you know, we also will give our client a quote comparison, which shows the fair market price, how China will that really look like. And not only that, we give our client a landed cost analysis to explain to our customer how this project will pan out, whether it's, you know, feasible to proceed further or not. So not only that, we explain to our customer that's the way we're going to deliver, but we also show them example. So at the end of the stage one, we once they engaged us at the completion meeting, I personally sit down with my customer, say, those are the three things I promised you, 1, 2, 3. Have we fulfilled our promises to you? They usually say yes. And if they don't, we would ask, you know, I would ask, you know, what's your concern? Is there anything, you know, we can, you know, do? And it's, you know, check feedback checking system, as well as, you know, the good customer service. When they said yes, I should pull up an extra piece of paper, which is a shortlisted supplier report. And we said, okay, we fulfilled our promises to you. We need something extra. And this is our standard procedure. We always do that. However, we don't tell them beforehand. But it became so useful when we have that meeting. They always felt, wow, they are special, which they are. And we deliver something just extra to make them sure, feel, wow, you know, we really delivered what we said, and we did something extra. So get constant feedback and maintain the relationship. So far we probably managed over, you know, 400 or 500 projects, and I don't have that, you know, enough time and to, you know, maintain the personal contact with every one of our customers. However, I make sure at the end of the stage one, I always allocate, you know, 1 hour to have that face-to-face or phone, direct phone meeting with my customer to get their feedback. And it's a must, it's our standard procedure. And even like I'm not in touch with the project anymore, but to get that customer feedback and to build that relationship, they felt they are really important. They felt, wow, they get the boss's attention for the project. And if they do have some concern, they have an opportunity to air out. And one thing I found out, you know, to give customers the opportunity to air out is actually the opportunity to build that report and creating the reading plan. And so also provided the reward system. And also in our staff or team member management system, we actually have each of those project turn out or the outcome clearly linked and correlated to their performance for their review.